for Syracuse features three freshmen, including Johnny Flynn, who played all 40 minutes in the loss to Cincinnati, scored 9 points, had 4 assists and 4 rebounds for the Orange. He'll run the point. And for West Virginia, Deshaun Butler could be important today. He averages 12 points a game, but has been foul prone, and with a lack of depth for West Virginia due to the nagging thigh injury of Joe Mazzulla, they're going to need Butler to play a lot of minutes here today. Jim Boeheim in his 32nd season, highlighted by that 2003 national championship. And Bob Huggins back home his first year in his hometown after 16 years at Cincinnati and spending last season at Kansas State. The Orange in their road orange, and West Virginia in the home gold jerseys.
And West Virginia starts out man to man. You're going to look for them to go at them right from the get-go defensively.
If the Orange will try to use that size advantage inside, that's been an issue for West Virginia in their Big East losses. And immediately the Orange get on the offensive boards and draw the foul.
One of the things that Huggy has wanted these guys to do is to get a lot tougher. And right here, you've got to get those defensive boards right off the bat.
Well, that'll send Harris to the free throw line. Paul, the 6'5 sophomore from Niagara Falls, short on the first, 69% from the line. He gets the second one to go. Then will pressure full court.
Syracuse this year playing a lot more man-to-man than they usually do. And maybe it's because they're so young and you want to instill those good defensive principles.
Well, certainly Jim Boeheim known for that 2-3 that Syracuse plays as well as anybody in the country. But with this young lineup, may take some time to pick all that stuff up. And Harris off the miss. Dante Green in transition. The pull-up three won't go, and over the back's going to be called on Scoot Jardine, the 6'1 rookie out of Philadelphia.
And you know, Coach Boeheim right away is motioning to Dante. What are you taking that shot for? And if there's a couple of things that he's got to do, I think, a lot better, and that is his shot selection. No need for a 6'11 guy to can play the way he does to pull up for a jump shot at the end of a fast break with nobody in rebound position.
Got to go all the way back to 2001 for the last West Virginia win in this series. Onuaku gets the steal. Green behind the back. And the return pass to Orenze for the lay-in, and Syracuse forces the quick timeout with the 3-0 lead. Bob Huggins not pleased at all with Smalligan on that last. Welcome back here to West Virginia. Syracuse with the early lead. We've talked about the youth of Syracuse, but certainly a lot of folks trying to get to know each other as we see the takeaway by the Orange. And on the West Virginia side with the new coach, Bob Huggins, coming in.
By all means, Beth, what you've got is you've got Bobby Huggins trying to instill his, you know, his fire into these guys. And he wants them to play with a lot more emotion and just be a lot more aggressive, whether they're at home or on the road.
26 seasons on the sideline for Huggins, 32 for Boeheim. They are both in the top 10. Amongst active coaches and wins and winning percentage. Butler, nice entry to Alexander with the flush right over the top of Onuaku. Tremendous elevation.
That'll get the crowd going, and that obviously when you play at home, you want to get the crowd involved.
Can't complete the three-point play. We'll keep an eye on the foul shooting. That's been an Achilles heel in Big East losses for West Virginia this year.
You know, I was looking at a stat, and it's really noteworthy, and that is that other than Ruoff and Alexander, the team, West Virginia as a team, shooting 58% from the free throw line.
They have missed 19 free throws in their two losses in the conference. And the Orange start out 1-for-4 from the floor. And Darris Nichols, the 6'3 senior from Radford, Virginia, playing in his 120th career game. He is just a few weeks away from spending more time in a West Virginia uniform than anybody in the history of this program. Alexander drops it off to Butler, no. Smith able to tip it to himself to keep it alive. Well, ricochets out of bounds, last touch by the Cuse.
And, you know, right there's an example of one of the things that Bobby wants Darris to do, and that is he wants him to be a little bit more aggressive, wants him to be a little bit more selfish, and maybe when he gets in the lane to look for his shot a little bit more than just his teammates.
And Huggins has gone to the bench early to bring on Wellington Smith and has taken Smalligan out of the lineup.
Syracuse now goes into the zone. This is where Ruoff becomes really a big, big key to this to success today.
Alexander repositions, but before he can get the shot up, it's a 3-second violation on the Mountaineers. A couple of early turnovers for West Virginia. They don't turn it over very often. They are 10th best in the nation at taking care of the basketball. The pull-up from Harris got it over Butler for two.
Continues to improve his game and basically add things to it. There's a guy that's averaging just about a double-double for the year. Not bad for a 6'5 guy.
And due to the graduation and the injuries for Syracuse, Harris is the only scorer of any substance that is back this year and playing.
Which is quite remarkable how well they've done so far with, you know, figuring all those freshmen they're playing. Yeah.
Lost their whole front line to graduation, and then the injuries to their perimeter players, Andy Routens and Eric Diebendorf.
And that's what Darris can do, I think, even more of, and take the ball to the basket and be a scorer, because he really knows how to use his body. I saw it firsthand last summer in Taiwan, where he was using his body against older guys.
There you see the numbers for Boeheim and Huggins, over 1,800 games that they've coached, over 1,300 victories. And the first time that they've both been on the sideline. They did see each other back in the 70s when Huggins was a player at West Virginia, and they did split their regular season matchups on that occasion. Back in the 1976-77 season.
Well, Huggy probably have to play the power forward now. He's put on a few pounds since those days.
Green, another three attempt. That one rattles in and out, and here's Nichols with the push. We swing it around in the corner. Smith thought about it. Perhaps a beat too long as he comes up short on the attempt.
Exactly. He does shoot that when he got it right away.
Jardine. Perhaps a spin too many on that miss.
Made that a lot tougher than it needed to be.
5-4 Orange early on. Just about 4 minutes gone in the first half. Harris finding some space along the baseline, though. Only locked through with the weak side rebound and stick back.
Well, they need him to be a consistent scorer for them, and particularly off the glass. He's a guy that should be getting them, you know, double figures each night, just rebounding alone.
He's close to a double-double, but somebody missed the assignment there as Smith all alone to the bucket for the jam.
Another youngster out of, another sophomore, really talented player. They like him a lot, and I can see why.
Out of Summit, New Jersey, getting his first bucket. And the 3-second violation called on Onuaku inside. Syracuse with the 7-6 lead, 4.5 gone in this Big East showdown between the Orange and the Mountaineers. 4.5 minutes gone here in the first half. Syracuse with the early lead over West Virginia here in Morgantown. And a big moment on December 22nd for Bob Huggins up in Buffalo. It was win number 600 for Coach.
A lot of wins. You know, to win 600, you got to coach about 1,000, I think.
They went up and beat Canisius up in Buffalo. He's added one more to that with the home win against Marquette. So he's at 601 right now. That was bracketed with the road losses at Notre Dame and at Louisville. It's a much different team here in the Coliseum than they are on the road over the last couple of years. They've got a 13-game win streak right now in this building.
They really are. And you know, they've always been that way. I remember when I was coaching against them back in the A-10 when Gil Catley was here. They always played so much better at home. I don't know what it is, but if they could find it and take it on the road with them.
Yep. In transition, Harris tried to roll it up and in, though. Wellington Smith with the rebound. Alexander looking for Ruoff, who's yet to pull the trigger from outside. High off the window from Deshaun Butler, the 6'7 sophomore out of Newark.
You know, part of that whole that thing about playing better maybe at home than on the road, it's got a lot of times to do not only with the crowd, they got a crazy group of guys here, but also maybe with the fact that they don't have that much depth, so they can't get the quality practice, you know, competition that they need.
They may only have 7 today, depending on how Del Mazzullo is dealing with his thigh bruise injury.
Well, before the game, I met a young man that's, I think, going to join them from the football team. I think they're number 2 quarterback. So they're recruiting off the football team. Don't blame them.
Jardine spinning into the lane, lost it, and then commits the foul. Well, the football team making some news this week as well. New coach Bill Stewart making some assistant coach hires in the last couple of days. And a lot of them are former West Virginia players and coaches joining his staff here as we take a look at the foul. And may have knocked knees on that. Jardine will go over to the sideline with a couple of fouls as well.
Well, Jardine was coming out on that move regardless of whether they knocked knees or not. That's the one thing Jimmy doesn't need is for him to be wheeling and dealing into the lane.
Three-pointer off the mark. Jardine replaced by Christophe Ogenaut, the 6'8 junior from Belgium in his first year at a junior college. Neither side able to dial it in from downtown just yet. A combined 0 for 6 for both these clubs. Green probing and then fades away and knocks it down.
He's so good. You know, you just keep wanting him to take it a little bit closer to the basket, but I tell you what, you don't average 20 points a game without a lot of game.
Leading the conference in scoring right now is the freshman. He and Johnny Harris, or Johnny Flynn rather, combining to be one of the top scoring freshman tandems in the nation. Let's take another look at the work of Green.
A little step back. You know that they work at now all the time in practice and at the camps. You mentioned the freshmen, the 2 All-Americans, the 2 McDonald's All-Americans. You know, when you talk about being young, but they play so many games now in high school, they don't come into college like freshmen used to years ago.
Morocco. Good ball pressure that time from West Virginia. Green misses from deep. Yeah, with the injury to Diebendorf and then Jardine got inserted into the starting lineup, it's the first time ever that Boeheim has had 3 freshmen in the lineup.
There aren't many teams that probably would have the success that they're having with 3 freshmen, unless they were as talented as these guys are.
Ruoff. Defense backed away, and Ruoff tried to take the opening. And it will be West Virginia basketball. ESPNU delivers college basketball Sunday night as Fort Valley State takes on Albany State. It's College Hoops on ESPNU Sunday night at 7:30 Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPNU.com. Alexander from the elbow, no, and Green's got the rebound. Green called for the carry before he could take it to the hoop. Coach, you can also visit ESPNU.com. Maybe check out that replay yesterday of that thrilling Georgetown-UConn game and Roy Hibbert taking it up beyond the arc for the game winner.
The big 7-foot, what, 3-inch guy or whatever.
Georgetown remains undefeated in the league at 3-0, the only unbeaten left in the conference. Parity might be the word to describe the Big East this year outside of Washington, D.C. Ruoff, there he is for his first triple of the day.
About time, you know, that's my Star Wars guy. I was wondering when he was going to knock one down. But, you know, you talk about the Big East, and I think parity is one word, but I think also youth is another. They're very young. It's a great league, but it's a young league.
Taken away by the Mountaineers, 4 turnovers now for Syracuse.
you know, with the lack of depth that West Virginia has, the one thing that they don't get very few of, and that is fast break baskets. They haven't got too many. It makes it really difficult, and that means they got to execute even better in the half court.
Alexander off the head fake. The skip looking for Ruoff. Shot clock's under 10. Alexander trying for three, no. Harris, nice dish. And then the block coming back from John Flowers to deny Rick Jackson. Nichols the other way, and it's a four-point swing for the Mountaineers.
And that was a fast break basket. Darris must have been listening. Another youngster, Jackson, another sophomore, teammate of Jardine in high school. That last layup, you just got to go up and lay it off the glass.
Got to bring it a little stronger against the Mountaineer D. It's a 9-2 run right now for West Virginia. Green.
Green.
Off glass for the three.
Well, I guess if you shoot them up long enough and deep enough, you get a little bounce once in a while, huh?
Now 1-for-4 from outside the arc for Dante.
You know, there's a whole new psychology now in coaching those super freshmen that probably are with you for a year. It's like you almost just let them play. I mean, years ago, you'd have taken a guy out for taking that shot. Yeah.
Nichols hangs with the left hand and scores.
Well, Darris must have heard us talking about the fact that he needs to be a little more selfish because he's actually helping his team now by being a lot more aggressive.
Another takeaway, the Mountaineers have numbers. Ruoff thinking of the number three. Green denied the baseline. Offensive foul. Ruoff hits the three at one end, takes the charge at the other. 18-12. Mountaineers, the defense leading the offense. And Ruoff knocks down from downtown. West Virginia actually with the lead over Syracuse. All the momentum right now in that huddle over there. And as Syracuse breaks the huddle, decision-making question mark, I think, so far on the offensive end for Syracuse.
No doubt about it. I mean, as talented as Dante Green is, to shoot 25-foot jump shots as regular as he does, I think it really hurts the team. And if he's not making those, you're also not going to get too many rebounds. And you give the other team a chance, even West Virginia, who doesn't like to run, to get some breakout baskets against you.
They've also turned it over six times, which hasn't helped the orange cause. It's 18-12, West Virginia. But Alex Ruoff already has a couple of triples on the offensive end
for
the Mountaineers.
But with that said, they're still only down six, so it's still a two-possession game.
You had him in your star watch. That was prophetic. They needed a scoring. They were getting it so far.
Well, usually, you know, he told me, I talked to him before the game. He said, Coach, I don't usually do too well when they pick me in the star watch. I said, you better do good tonight.
Rattled around and out by John Flowers. So here come the orange.
And notice Missoula's in. Hopefully they can get a couple of minutes out of him just to give Darris a little bit of a break.
Butler taking it right at Green. It won't go. Second chance, no. Third opportunity, and that'll draw the foul.
There you get a lot of banging going on, a physical game, which is typical of Big East basketball, and it's really about which team can have the most legs to be able to go up for those second and third shots. And of course, when you don't play many people off your bench, you don't get that many second and third shots.
May not be an issue right now, but it certainly could be later today with both clubs probably limited to seven, maybe eight guys.
Right.
And the turnover by West Virginia.
You know, everybody goes in, they all say, you know, Coach, we want to run, we want to press, we want to play 38, 40 minutes a game. Now you get a chance to do it, and you find out the kind of incredible shape you have to be in and how smart you have to be to stay out of foul trouble as well. this guy's been quiet tonight. Mr. Flynn, he's probably got to start to get a little more involved in the offense.
0 for 1 so far without an assist for Johnny, who comes in averaging 14 points and 6 assists per game. The 6-foot freshman out of Niagara Falls played together in high school with Paul Harris, his teammate here at Syracuse. And a held ball. We're seeing why West Virginia has the top turnover margin in the conference at +7 so far this year. Their defense has been very stingy. Side action for you here as the Mountaineers have the 18-12 lead over Syracuse. Neither side shooting it all that effectively so far here this afternoon.
No, they're not, and I think a lot of that has to be attributed to the defense. Both teams right now are getting after it. Can they sustain that though with those very, very short benches that they have?
7 turnovers for Syracuse in the early going. Dante Green is 2 of 6. He's got 4 points. Harris with 6 to lead the Orange. And on the other side for the Mountaineers, 6 apiece for Ruoff and Nichols. Good perimeter scoring for the Mountaineers. Ruoff is out right now.
As is Harris from Syracuse. Real, you know, kind of a gutsy move here. But everybody needs a blow.
Missoula with under 10 now on the shot clock. Nichols trying to probe that 2-3 zone, and the travel called before Missoula could get the shot off. Good defensive stand there by the Orange.
Very good defensive stand, and you know what? Sometime a fresh player, even though he's a little bit less talented, can give you a good lift on the defensive end.
Harris pops back off the bench and is reinserted into the lineup now for Syracuse. Green with Alexander on him defensively. Harris leaves it off for Onuaku. Now Green trying to come get it. 10 on the shot clock. Green trying to back inside.
Wow.
And the foul is called on the fadeaway with 7 seconds on the shot clock.
You know, you force a guy to take a bad shot. That was a bad shot. You'll see it here off the reverse dribble. And then the fadeaway, the last thing you want to do is try and block that shot, because realistically, most of those aren't going in anyhow.
Bob Huggins agrees to disagree with the official on that call as Green hits the free throw. A 74% free throw shooter. He leads Syracuse this year in scoring and in blocked shots.
And Bobby's probably saying to the ref, hey, listen, ref, that's a bad shot. I mean, what are you going to call foul on that for? You know, I can remember saying that a few times myself.
The Orange back within 4 as Nichols now brings it across. He and Ruoff are back out there. Inside to Smith. Tries the baseline, no. Smith flashes high. Onuaku was right there with him again. The shot clock winding down. Nichols spinning and hitting.
They scored, but that was an awfully tough basket. They had to work very hard, you know, for basically a tough shot. They've got to find a way of getting easier shots, and the way to do that against Syracuse, you got to get that ball in around the high post. You also got to get it down to the shot corner on the baseline.
And a 5-second violation called out top on Flynn.
Taking a look at that, this last possession, I mean, it's a lot of work to end up with that shot, even though it went in. But as long as West Virginia struggles, Beth, with the zone, Syracuse will continue to stay in the zone, which is what they'd rather play anyhow.
Nichols back to Butler, baseline, got it for 2. So now the other end, Syracuse in the midst of a 4.5-minute scoring drought. Green to Flynn. Look at him hang and score and take the contact.
He is so good in and around the basket. I mean, he can stay, he can change hands. And you'll see right here on a good pass by Mr. Green, that great hang and the use of the left hand by the freshman.
First basket for Flynn, New York's Mr. Basketball last year in high school. Spent some time this past summer with the USA Basketball on the U19 team. You coached some of these guys too, didn't you, this summer?
Oh, I did. I had the backcourt for West Virginia, Darius Nichols and Alex Ruoff. They were my backcourt for the AIA team, the Athletes in Action, in the Jones Cup over in Taiwan. And we played 9 games in 9 days against a lot of teams who are getting ready for the upcoming Olympics. So they've had some great competition, these guys, and they fared very well.
Jardine tries to drop it off. Onuaku has it sent back by Smith.
And I love coaching this guy, Darius Nichols. I mean, if anything, the thing I wanted him to do is the same thing Huggy wants him to do, and that is get a little bit more selfish.
The 6'3 senior, in his second year as the starter, takes tremendous care of the basketball for West Virginia. One of those unsung heroes for them. You don't hear much about him on the stat page.
No, he just helps you win basketball games. And you know what? He's going to make a living playing somewhere after West Virginia. And he will graduate in May. Talking to him yesterday, he's right on time for his degree. And he's a great young man. And that's what, you know, coaching college basketball is all about, coaching guys like him.
Nichols and Small again, the only seniors in the rotation this year. And another whistle and a foul as Jackson earns a trip to the line.
And I'm sure coach isn't too pleased with the fact that he missed that point blank layup. You gotta make those. You get the foul in there, those are 3-point plays you gotta make.
As you alluded to, a teammate of Scoop Jardine's at Newman Goretti High School in Philadelphia, they both decided to come together to Syracuse.
Well, you know, on that team, you've got two pairs of players that are together. You've got Jardine and Jackson, and then you've got Harris and young Johnny. I mean, those two guys played together in Niagara.
Jackson gets the second one. For up to the minute news for everything that is college sports, log on to ESPNU.com. If you don't have ESPNU, be sure to log on and type in your zip code at the top of the page or call your local cable operator or satellite provider and visit ESPNU.com today. Under 4.5 to go, 22-18, West Virginia with the lead over Syracuse. The Orange at 2-1 in the conference, the Mountaineers are 1-2 on the season, both those losses coming on the road. Had a big home win against Marquette here. And the three ball as the shot clock was winding down from Darius Nichols. 11 points in the first half for Nichols.
He's a gamer. Surprised Syracuse isn't trying to go into the low post just a little bit, because, you know, West Virginia wants to front everything. Another Palmen call. That's what, the second or third one today?
Second one so far.
Officials must have talked about that before the game.
Ninth turnover committed by the Orange. Huggins has his club on top, 25-18 here at West. 25-18, West Virginia on top of Syracuse. 3:39 to go in the first half. And a reoccurring issue for West Virginia has been the foul trouble that Deshaun Butler has gotten into on occasion. And he just picked up his second there before the break.
Well, you can look for him to be on the bench for the rest of this half. I don't think Bob's going to put him back in. He needs this young fella, you know, as light as they are in numbers and as talented as Butler is, he needs him on the court. Butler's got to learn how to play and stay out of foul trouble. He's got to be a little bit wiser at the defensive end and at the offensive end of the court.
He's fouled out of 4 games this year.
Too many.
Had that stellar rookie campaign where he was scoring in double digits coming off the bench last year, a member of the All-Big East rookie team. And he'll be watching for a while. John Flowers is out there on the baseline for West Virginia in his place. Missoula.
Right now, West Virginia's just playing catch on the perimeter. Got to get the ball somehow into the teeth of the zone. Got to get it in to that foul line area and then down along the baseline.
Shot clock again winding down. Nichols has to hang and he scores over the top of Jackson. 13 in the first half for Darris to go along with three assists. He's hit five of six shots.
And all, you know, once again, all very, very big shots, obviously, as every shot is.
The block on the shot from Green out top. Missoula found himself alone, came up short. Nichols feeling it right now. Not enough legs on that one.
That last block by Flowers was, I believe, his 18th of the year, and I think he leads West Virginia in blocks.
Ruoff found some space and knocked it down.
Nothing like home cooking. I'll tell you what, when you're a shooter, you want to shoot in your gym, and obviously tonight, Ruoff is very, very happy to be at home.
Averages three a game. He's already got three of them here in the first half.
And he's feeling it. I mean, he's shooting it. He's keeping that follow-through up. He's looking at the crowd, and he's feeling pretty good tonight.
An 8-0 run in the last minute and a half for West Virginia as they bump the lead up to 30-18. Minor that coming up at the half. We'll take a look at some of the top point guards. Also our conference beat. And the first half highlights and stats.
Well, Beth, if you're Syracuse right now and it's 2:19 to go in this half and it's 30-18, as the coach, you're thinking to yourself, what I want to do right now is I want to get this under 10. I want to go in under 10. I want to have a little bit of run to end out this half, and so we can feel good about ourselves at halftime and get ready for the second half.
So far for the Orange, Green with 7 points. Flynn with three. They miss it inside. The Orange just 30% from the floor in the first half. Missoula trying to wrap it around. Good recovery by Jackson to help out defensively. Jardine held up by Ruoff, and the possession arrow will keep it with Syracuse.
Jardine's over penetrating, continues to put his head down and try to get into the lane even when there's nothing there. He's got to be a little bit more patient.
Then we'll get it back out top to Green, and now Syracuse will reset with 15 on the shot clock. Harris down low. Jackson that time a little stronger to the bucket, and he finishes.
Yeah, they need that from him. Well, it's 10. Now you need a stop if you're Syracuse. Another basket, and you start feeling good about yourself again.
Ruoff. Clock making him work, whip it around. Ruoff, his fourth triple of the first half.
Feeling good. Maybe the jinx, the Star Watch jinx, is over for him.
And Ruoff takes the charge of Flynn at the other end. We'll check that at Missoula.
You know, it's the little things. You bring a guy in off the bench, and even though he might be a little bit on the injured side, you get that, you take that charge. To start feeling pretty good, and the injury doesn't feel as bad either.
Just 7 minutes in their loss to Louisville, and Missoula getting more than that here in the first half.
Syracuse stays zone, and you'll probably see them stay just because of the depth or lack of depth.
Alexander double teamed in the corner, in some trouble, lost the handle. Syracuse gets it back. Shot clock is off. Green off the hesitation and is pushed on the baseline drive.
See if they call that on a shot, or actually it was a pass, it looked like. You hear that whistle, you got to throw it up there. I'm surprised that you know, he didn't just throw it up to the basket.
Second foul on Joe Alexander. Dante Green. No good from three-point range.
Fall away from three, to be exact.
Green has taken seven shots. Five of them have been from beyond the arc in this first half. Chance for the final shot for West Virginia.
Got a chance to go up by 16.
Ruoff, no. The tip is up and in from John Flowers. Take the 15-point lead into the line. first half on the perimeter for West Virginia. Ruoff and Nichols combining for 25 of their 35 points, and they finish up the half on a 13-2 run, and they've got the